everybody. I'm Adam Hergenrother, and this is Business Meets Spirituality. We believe in personal growth through business success. I am joined by my chief of staff, Hallie Warner. Hallie, good morning.
Life is full right now.
Life is full.
I was waiting for you to ask me the question, how are you? And I would have said.
I know.
Life is full.
It is full. It is full. It is full. It is full of challenges. It is full of opportunities. It's full of questions.
Yes.
Right. It's full of...
fun.
It is. And it's actually full of coldness today. It's actually
you're cold?
Well, not today, like personally, but like, it's like, I was in Austin, it was 93. I flew back and it was like 40 degrees
in Vermont. Like 40 this
it's
morning,
like
yeah.
full on fall.
Yes.
Which is actually quite wonderful.
I love it.
Yes,
fall.
Me too.
Yeah.
I do. Who doesn't like putting on a hoodie, by the way? Because you know that I love hoodies.
Well, not everybody enjoys the hoodie.
I know. I've actually had them in my closet and I've just been staring at them every day because it's been too hot to wear them because we've had a lot of hot weather here. And now I'm like, oh, I get to break out my hoodies again.
Oh my God. I need to get you that that I don't know if it was the brand, a spiritual gangster.
Brad got me that.
Oh, did he?
Yes, he did.
Oh, that's a whole brand.
Oh, is it?
Yeah. Yes. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, it was pretty. It's actually really comfortable too.
Yeah. Okay.
It's comfortable for like your pajamas. Comfortable.
Oh, you're not going to wear it. To the... Yeah, yes, no, it's a very thin.
Yes,
like,
it's like a, yeah, exactly.
Yes.
Yeah. That's exactly what it's comfortable for.
It's loungewear.
Yes, it is.
For women. Loungewear.
Women probably
no,
it's still
I think,
it's
I don't
still
think it
it's
is.
Still comfortable whatever it is still comfortable
okay
somebody actually what? Sent me over on this conversation that somebody sent me over this these really like sweatpants and things that are like for athletic wear but they're supposed to be used for like sweatpants you can wear all day
yeah joggers
and, yeah exactly what they are and they're really comfortable but I don't know how anybody would wear those things like
in public. Well, somebody at Project U, I was going to shout him out. He probably wouldn't care if I did, wore those kind of pants. You know who I'm talking about?
I think so. I don't really know.
Yeah, they look good.
Yeah. I mean, I guess so. Yeah.
Okay. Are we going to focus now?
Let's focus.
We're going to answer a question that we posted, I think a couple of weeks ago on social media and got a lot of really interesting responses. So we thought we'd kind of talk about it a little bit because I think you can interpret the question a couple of different ways. So here's the question and I'll let you go. The question is, how old would you be if you didn't know how old you are?
So what would your answer be, Hallie?
Well, I do know how old I am. I'm 36. And my answer immediately is 35. And why? And I'm probably interpreting the question like more about
what age
would I want to be forever is how I interpret.
That actually wasn't the question.
That's how I'm interpreting the question.
Well, you changed the question around.
How old would you be if you didn't know how old you are?
Yeah.
I would say 35.
Yeah, but you said it for the different reasons. You said you'd be 35 because that's what you want to stay at.
Correct. But I also just feel I'm like a 35-year-old, you know?
Yeah, that's awesome.
I feel like I'll always kind of be that.
Why? I mean, I'm just curious about what's 35 for you. How do you know that 45 is not better?
Well, I don't know yet, I guess.
I know. So how do you know that you want to make such a conviction to be at this age? I'm just curious.
How old would you be if you didn't know? I mean, it's an interesting question. How would you answer it?
You're trying to deflect right here?
Yes.
Yes, you are. I'm actually curious to why would you want to pick 35?
Yeah, because for a couple of different reasons. The first word that comes to mind is stability.
Yeah.
Very stable in my relationship. At that point, I'd been with Bill for 17 years.
Yeah.
Very stable in all of my relationships and with my personal life, my family.
In a good spot.
Career.
Yeah.
Great. House solid. Finances.
Yeah.
Great. Like just stable.
Yeah. You know, it's funny. And
yet still have all of my life
to look ahead to.
Yeah, yes.
Yes. Assuming you get there. You know, the
thanks.
You're welcome. Well, you know, it's funny because a lot of people did answer it that way, right? Like, hey, I'd want to be this. But it's funny. People went back to a memory. Nobody says now, which I thought was kind of fascinating. Nobody said, I'm just happy to be right where I want to be.
Yeah, that's interesting. I guess I kind of feel that way because the age is pretty close to my
age. Don't try to jump up to the question now. Like you said, you were 35. It was just really interesting that I noticed that when I read that, like nobody said, well, I'm actually really happy to be where I am right now. So it means that people are still living a future or past event, right?
Yeah.
Some people were like, hey, I can't wait till I'm a certain age or most people went backwards into a time that had a memory that was wonderful and that had and it was there instead of actually making the present moment wonderful. That wasn't the whole point of the thing. And that's not
the question.
But I just thought that was an interesting takeaway. way. Yeah. People always went back to some previous time. In fact, it's interesting because I just turned 40 and people said, hey, the best time of my entire life was the decades in my 40s.
Yeah.
And then, you know, Maya Angelou, I love the way she said, she goes, I was in my 40s and I thought that was the best year. Then I was in my 50s and I thought that was the best decade. And then my 60s were absolutely just amazing. I didn't think they could get any better. And then my 70s were just off the rocker.
Yeah.
And the way she says it, I'll never forget that whole you know,
I'm sorry. I was going to say, some people answered the question, which I thought was interesting. Well, I think it's because everyone has a different interpretation of what age means. Mm-hmm. So if somebody, it was almost like it represented something. So I'm just kind of giving
physicality.
An example. Yeah, yeah. Like somebody might've said 21
exactly,
because they were at their peak fitness and maybe they still are.
Yeah.
So they are like, that's how old I am. And that's actually not the point I was going to make about memory. I was actually going to make the point more of when you're in your 20s, it's supposed to be that most physically fit time.
Yeah.
So if somebody now in their 60s is that super, super physically fit, they might then say, well, I'm 21.
Yeah, they extrapolate that. You know, it's interesting. Yeah. I think I'm in the best shape of my life every year that I keep getting older. And I think that's really cool. I think that's also because lack of stress, the eating gets continued to be refined year after year after year, mm-hmm. right? All those type of things. And consumption and just sleep, exercise, all that stuff just becomes, I think, so no matter where you are, you can say, well, I can do any of that right now, right? That's what's preventing you from doing that. I always ask that question. People bring stuff up like that. I'm like, well, what's preventing you from doing that right now?
Yeah.
But the whole point of the question, right? How old would you be or how old do you think you are? If you don't know how old you are, the whole essence of this is it originates from a Zen Buddhism type of question, right? Which is they're called koans, right? And a koan is designed so that you can't actually answer it with your mind. And probably the most famous koan that's out there is, what is the sound of one hand clapping? Right. That's what, if you were to ask anybody that's in that field, that would be the question, like, what's the most famous koan, right? And a koan is K-O-A-N, right? And it's just, what is the sound of one hand clapping? The additional question you can ask is how old are you if you don't know how old you are? And the reality is, most people would go to their head and try to answer it. Again, memories. Mm-hmm. So that's funny. That's just because this actually doesn't exist. It exists somewhere, but it's not like people can't open it up and see your memory bank.
I was going to say memories, but also just conscious thought.
Yeah. Well, too, you're right? Going to your mind.
Correct.
To think about it.
Yes.
Right. Which is what we're trained to do in particularly Western societies, go there. In Eastern societies, and this is where it originated from, it's been going on for thousands of years, by the way, koans were written on walls early on in the day. And it was designed to, foster faster growth towards enlightenment. Right. Enlightenment, again, doesn't mean you're an enlightened master. There's many different levels of enlightenment. Enlightenment is just more of like, I'm awake, I've merged. Like, there's awakened beings. Enlightened being means I recognize that there's something much more than me. And these questions can't be answered the way they're supposed to be answered with intellectual mind. And so if you're actually practicing Zen Buddhism and they ask you this question and you said, I want to be 35, they might give you a literal smack with a ruler, right? Like, you know, light one, like, hey, that's not the whole point. Think about it some more. They don't mean think about it, just like go ask the question. And part of the process of actually going through there is to realize I don't need the mind to answer that question. And I can actually just have a knowing of the question. We're going to get there. But that knowing of the question eliminates the thinking of the conscious mind, and then it becomes a knowing of what that answer truly is. And that was the path. It's been used many times now, like the sound of one hand clapping. What is it? Somebody be like, well, I know exactly what it is. And they hit two hands, they do this stuff. They come up with, even if you came up with the most intellectual correct answer with the best use of the words that you could do or describe all this, it's still wrong because you're still going to something that can't give you the answer. It'll come up with one and it'll dance around the edges and it'll be really, really clear and it'll be perfect, but it's still not the answer you're looking for because knowing cannot be described with intellectual mind.
Can koans have right and wrong answers?
I don't know if there is an answer. That's the thing. It's not an answer the way you think of an answer. Like,
well,
hey,
you just said my answer is wrong.
Well,
so
yeah, it's more of a lighter term of saying that.
Yes.
I think you're missing the context, I guess, would be a better way of saying that then, right? Just lightness is wrong, but you're missing the reason of asking the question in the first place.
So how might you answer that question?
Well, you can't answer it, right? You just know it. And once you know it, and the knowing, it's hard to explain. Like, what does an orange taste like to somebody who's never tasted an orange? What does a rainbow look like to somebody who's blind? Explain that to them. You can't until they know it.
but you can try.
You can, yeah, absolutely. And that's what people do. People, that's what you, people try to explain it, and they may be a pointer finger and they may give them some help, but all of that's irrelevant, because then you're just using your mind for you to try to analyze what words they use and what that word means to you and what that means to them and how that can be in there. And then you kind of put it in there and you're just, all you're doing is thinking.
So
the whole point is to actually move away from the thinking mind,
yeah,
and go beyond the thinking mind, which is where enlightenment or awakened being lives. Remember, enlightenment or enlightened being uses the mind as a tool, not the mind using you to run or control the narrative of your life. And that's what happens when you try to answer it with that, is it's telling you what the answer is.
Do you know the answer to that question?
Yes, I do. There's a knowing of the answer of that, right?
But you can't explain it.
You can't. Well, you can try to with different words, right? There's this, a lot of the, and there's actually like a famous answer that you can have for that, but they don't like you sharing it because it's not there. But there's a sense you can use with words that describes that, even the sound of one hand clapping, right?
That's the answer out for that one is pretty common.
Yeah, it is.
It's everywhere.
Yes.
Which is?
Well, it's basically saying that like the sound of the whole universe is clapping. Yes. And the whole universe in itself is one gigantic contraction, one clap. It's not you individually, yeah, clapping.
I would never have intellectually clapping. Gotten to that answer.
Yes. Well, but the thing is because you can't really like, but and then, but you have to experience that knowing to understand, yeah, what that really, that answer is.
Right.
Because if I say that, people go, oh, I get it. No, what you've gotten is a conceptual abstract answer that you're using your mind to define for you. That's what people need to take away from all of koans in general, or any of these questions, is that you're still using your mind to formulate a new concept or an image instead of actually getting beyond that, which is where, again, an awakened being, an enlightened being, because that's really what koans are designed for. I mean, actually, it's funny because the definition, I looked up before, a definition of a koan is a paradoxical antidote or riddle used in Zen Buddhism to demonstrate the inadequacy of logical reasoning and to provoke enlightenment.
Mm, yeah.
And so like the whole point of koans is to realize the mind can't take you to where you're trying to go if, in this context, your path is enlightenment or awakening. Your mind will never take you there. The mind will just answer something and keep you attached to it. So the whole point of having these techniques, which is all they are, is to get you to go, I can't use the mind there. And so it starts putting your awareness on something beyond your mind. And as you put your awareness on something beyond your mind, it starts to open up a new dimension, which is the growth of consciousness within you, which then you can start seeing it and you know it at that stage. As you start to know that, you realize what the mind actually is. That's the whole provoking of enlightenment. What do you think?
I just want to know the answer to the question.
I know. Well, that's, and the thing is that people that are more analytical and more, yeah, intelligent want more answers.
Yeah.
Right? They want more, they want substance answers of the physical thing. And that, and if you're, but if your path is awakened or enlightenment or a future, your consciousness, it can't be answered in that way. Just like, how do you explain love to somebody, right? I don't mean any type of love that you want, love for a kid, love for an animal, love for nature. It doesn't matter, right? Love for another human being.
Yeah. Yes.
How do you describe that in words?
Well, you can get really, I get it. Like you can get really close.
But until somebody experiences
until you
that.
Experience, you don't really truly know, but you can.
But once you know, you go.
Through words.
Absolutely. They're pointer
it.
Fingers, right? If, yes. Like, it's like.
And some people explain it better than others and.
Totally. I mean, well, and the thing is, and better than others, some
although,
people
just. Although I was going to say, that's also completely
yeah,
subjective.
Yeah, because some people yeah. hear it differently yeah. and they go, you go, I didn't get it at all. And somebody else goes, I got it clearly.
Right.
I mean, every time we
well,
teach.
Well, because it's based on your own
exactly.
experiences and your own various knowings along the way.
That's exactly right. So, I mean, that's the beauty about koans, and you should, people can think and meditate. That's what they would say. They it wouldn't, I'm sorry, I misspoke earlier. They wouldn't say go think about this. They say go meditate on it.
Yes.
And that's, mm-hmm. it's because it's the whole point is to get out of your, is the logical reasoning mind that you have, which is a great tool and a wonderful one. It got us to where we are today and able to even record this podcast. If you don't have conversations to this language, all that stuff. But when you go meditate on it, it's to say, I'm going to remove myself from the logical mind, the left side of the brain, right? We did a whole podcast with how neuroscience is catching up, right? On this. So if you want to learn about language, you can go back and listen to that episode with one of our guests. But this is the koans are designed to go meditate on something beyond that. Like literally go. And when I first, somebody told me years ago, like, hey, what is the sound of one hand clapping? I, the first thing I did was like go to my mind to do it. Okay. And then over time, I
just Googled.
Well, you went to your mind said go Google, right?
Yes.
So then, but when you actually, even if you know the answer,
yeah.
just go there and actually meditate on it. Like, what is that? Because ego is a contraction. So isn't the world is a contraction, right? So ego is like a, like when you get angry, there is a contraction that is happening, right? Like you tighten up, mm-hmm. right? That's just, it's the egoic level of anger, irritation, jealousy, frustration. All of those cause a tightening, right? Mm-hmm. It's just a contraction in the world. Everything contraction extracts. And so that's the once, it's the whole universe clapping because you are actually part of the whole universe.
I don't know why I just thought of this when you were explaining that, but all of those, what are commonly referred to as more negative emotions, are this contraction.
Yeah.
And then I think of love, joy, fulfillment,
yes.
their expansion.
Expansion. It's exactly
right. I
don't
know why I didn't just, I mean, like I knew that, but it just.
You just had a knowing.
Yes. And I was like, oh, and that is the, that yes. you need both.
Yes.
To,
that is the sound of one yeah. hand clapping.
Yeah.
It's the whole contraction of the universe. That's it. There's in, there's out, there's flow, there's there. That's why sometimes water still, sometimes a leaf rattles it. It's all of it, right? So it's always expansion and contraction. Your breath expands and contracts. Night mm-hmm. and day expands and contracts, right? Mm-hmm. Well, technically, right? Yeah. But like everything, your breath, everything. Well,
contrast.
Yes, yeah. Everything's kind of going there. So it's the sound of one hand clapping. It's just the whole universe. There's no, and then there's a whole bunch of like little cycles in there that are kind of contracting, you know, like your breath. But the whole universe is in a contraction phase all the time.
And then well, in an expansion and contraction.
Exactly. Expansion, yes. contraction, expansion, contraction. That's why if you get to like, this is getting deeper, but like if you get to like lunar, like readings, like you, like I've done a lot of readings with pundits in India, right? About like your future based on your birth chart of when you are. And really what they're doing is they're comparing it to the lunar cycle, which is an expansion contraction.
Exactly.
Of like, hey, today's a great time to go out there. It's your energy can be wider today, right? Mm-hmm. Or today's not a good time. There's less available energy within the universe to be able to go out there for good deeds, whatever it is, right? I'm just kind of giving you examples, mm-hmm. but it's really what they're saying is just, they're talking about where do you line up in this day on terms of expansion and contraction from mm-hmm. the whole universe.
Yeah.
That's where they base all of that stuff on. And so when he says like, how old am I? If you didn't know how old you are, if you get out of your mind, what you realize is that you actually have no age. There is no age. And I can even ask other questions that go with that. It's like, when you ask that, it's like, if you go beyond the mind, you realize I'm there. There is no age. Like, what color are you? What do you look like beyond the mind? What do you feel like? Right? What denseness are you? And I'm serious. Like you, yeah. and there is no answer. The answer is for age is there is no age. There is no denseness. I actually have no color. It's just, you're there. And you can actually go beyond, and then the mind will jump in and say, well, no, you're a human being. You're, yes, that's the form that you're taking right now, living through a human experience. But who you really are is way beyond that. And that way beyond that is you to be able to get beyond the mind. And that's kind of explaining enlightenment, awakening, because people are using these words so interchangeably that people need to stop using the word enlightenment, because only masters are really truly enlightened. Enlightenment really, in my definition, is how I see this, is somebody who's in a permanent state of merging themselves in the universe. Right, like the Buddha, right, or Jesus Christ, right, or any of those people that have taken Mother Teresa, right, like they're just so merged, right, like it's like the Buddha said when he came back, like he was like saw like himself as like a using words to describe what he felt, mm-hmm. like he was a raindrop falling into the ocean. When he fell into the ocean, he said, "Find me." How would you find a raindrop falling into an ocean? You can't. That's how he now saw himself everywhere, right?
So, what word would you use instead of? An enlightened.
Well, I think individual. awakened person.
Okay.
Which really what awakened means, which is, I believe, where my path is, right? You're awakened enough. Like, I get pulled out of awakened too, right? I get pissed off sometimes, mm-hmm. anger, and I recognize it. The difference is how fast you get out of it.
Exactly.
Right? Like, maybe it pulls, like, when somebody says something about you, an awakened being or enlightened being may not feel anything, right? Because they're just in such a state. An awakened being goes, oh shit, that kind of hurt. Okay, now it's mm-hmm. gone. And I don't mean gone like you're trying to get it out. It's like the energy isn't there anymore. Right. It came in, you felt it, and it's out. Just like the wind blows, it blew the emotion right through you. But as it blew the emotion through you, you felt it, right?
And years prior, it might have taken weeks to...
Or never.
...move through that.
Many people have never gone through it. People say they get divorced, but you're not divorced. You're still living inside your mind with the person. Mm. Right? I mean, seriously, yeah. Like, oh, Matt's going to be there. I'm not going to that party.
Yeah.
Like they're still living in it. It's like the emotion has, well, you divorced. Yes, you divorced physically, but not mentally. I don't want to call this person. I don't want to be there if they're going to be there. It's like, well, what do you mean? I thought you're divorced. No, they could be there. I don't want to see them. Right. And so the whole thing is like it, and maybe you just decide not to go, that's different. But if you're going there to try to avoid something else, it means that your energy still built up inside you. It means you haven't, an awakened being means I recognize when I'm being taken out of center of myself or balanced and when I'm not. And when I, and then there's this moment that, you know, as you, on your path to personal growth, consciousness growth, spiritual growth, it doesn't, it's irrelevant what word you use, right? It's all the same, right? When you come down to this moment, there's a moment right before you're about to lose your seat of self, or just use a non-Zen word, when you're about to be, where your energy is about to shift to a defensive position, mm-hmm. or you're just going to be off balance. And everyone knows what that means, right? I don't have to, hopefully, like when you're about to get angry, you feel the anger coming in, and then all of a sudden you recognize the minute when you're angry. Yes. There's a moment there that you can actually pause, use your willpower, which is willpower is really designed for, and not touch it. And an awakened being is better at that. And so that when they see the moment, they go, I'm about to get hit. I'm being hit. I'm seeing it. I feel it. I'm not going to touch it. It's still there. I can see it. It's gone. Mm. That's it.
And that just gets smaller. That little, that it just, that moment gets smaller and smaller and smaller, yeah. And maybe even becomes non-existent.
At some point. Right. I think Michael Singer actually gave me an example one time, not to me personally, but he gave an example out there that he said, he used to teach this in the '70s. He said like an average person's mind, I think I may even share this before, like an average person's mind, like they're driving around, they're going, oh, look at the, you know, I just got on the road. Why is everyone driving 30 miles an hour, 35 in here? It's just ridiculous. Oh, look at that cow. Who wants a cow? This is ridiculous. Like, okay, look at this like tree. It's bent over here. Oh man, somebody's got a Ferrari. They got a Ferrari. Why would they get a red Ferrari? I don't even understand. It's top down. You can't even drive it. If I was gonna get a Ferrari, I'd have a black one. Oh man, somebody's eating an apple over here in this stand. I wish I had an apple, but I had a banana this morning instead of an apple. I should have chosen an apple. Why didn't I choose an apple? Right? That's how somebody's mind talks the whole time. A yogi's mind who's dedicated to the path of awakening, well, this is what it'll look like. They're driving down, they're like, oh, the 25th, there's an apple. You know, there's a Ferrari. Like, it just, the thought starts to come in and they just don't touch it. And so therefore, they never grabs a hold of them, so they stay centered.
Meaning, because the first example you gave to me sounds like it, observation coupled with judgment and stories that someone tells themselves.
What exactly the egoic level of consciousness
does?
But
then the second version you said, it just sounds like observance to me.
It's just awareness, awakened.
Without, because they still see things, but there's no judgment or story attached to it.
The first thing they'll teach you when you go into Zen Buddhism is a rock is a rock, a tree is a tree, and a flower is purple. And you just say it again. Like there's a purple flower there. A rock's a rock. The highest form of enlightenment is detachment from anything. I mean, you're not seeing yourself in it. You're just seeing it for what it is. And most people don't do that. Most people are listening to the narration or judgment of their stories based mm-hmm. on their mind. So when we ask a question like, how old are you? Mm-hmm. Right? If you don't know how old you are, people go to the judgment mind. It's a way of saying you go to your mind for everything. It's not right.
Is the right answer whatever age you currently are? Because that's just an observation.
No, yes, physically in this lifetime, yeah, whatever the age, if you just want to use it. But what if somebody, another group in India used a different way of referencing words or year or letter or letters or how old you are? Yes. So it's almost irrelevant. We just all made up. 35 years, that's just a made up term for us to communicate, which is fine. Just don't get attached to it. Right? Versus you get beyond your mind and you're just in a seat of self, which is like you see the world for what it is. A rock is a rock, a tree is a tree, and a purple flower.
Why is the flower purple and not just a flower?
You see a purple flower, it's a purple flower. You go, why is it purple? How come it's not yellow? Now you're going to your mind.
I'm just giving you shit a little bit because a rock is a rock, a tree, a tree. Why isn't a flower a flower?
No, a flower is a flower.
Okay.
There you go. Right. And it can be whatever color it is. It's still the flower, it's just there. Age is just age. It's just a term. It's not you. None of that is. And so all these koans are designed for you to meditate on. And if you can use this type of practice daily, and you can do this. And this is why I love the spirituality component in our lives where we are today, which is why business is a conduit for our personal growth, our spiritual growth, our conscious growth, because we don't live in a society where we're going to go sit in a cave and meditate and not be bothered for 36 hours a day, right? I know it's 24, but you get my point, right? That's easy, right? You hear a lot of spiritual teachers, like, it'd be very easy to go meditate all day and be in this wonderful state because you're not, anything's nothing bothering you because you're avoiding the world, right? Versus now we're in this part of this world where we just go get to interact with it and we're choosing to do it in business. Some people may do it in school. school teaching. Some people may do it in janitorial. Some people may do it in engineering, whatever it is. You're just out there experiencing it. And there's a whole bunch of stuff that's going to come in and it's going to show you what's messed up in you. And that's your opportunity to let go. It's not designed to move away from it and not have money or have money. That's the point. When people say, I'm just going to give all my money up away for simplicity. Well, that's the same thing going after money. It's the same negative energy. You're still just using a distraction instead of interacting with life. And that's what an awakened person just wakes up every day and says, I'm an apple tree. Apple trees produce apples sometimes. Sometimes they don't. And when I do, I drop them for everyone to come. It's like you're just, I'm using an example, but they just serve and contribute. Right? That's really all that it is.
Sorry.
And you're getting all, and you're just getting excited.
I was trying to avoid.
I know, I saw that. That was good. You did a good job for a little bit there.
Yeah.
So to wrap this up, use any of these or just go find your, just go Google koans and a whole bunch will pull up and just use this as a practice, as a meditative state. And by the way, when you feel like you are starting to get pulled into it and you have the awareness to go, what could be a good koan? Just ask the questions. What is the sound of one hand clapping? And it should pull you out. Or what age am I, if I don't know what age I am? Or another one you could ask is like, you know, what did you look like before you were born? That's another great koan. And the answer is because you can't physically go there and do that. You go to your mind instantly first. But if you get beyond the mind, you go, what did I look like before I was born?
I just instantly think of the movie Soul.
Yeah, because you have an image.
Yeah.
And because your mind triggered it and said, what's the closest thing that I can give to Hallie that gives her a representation of something that she can use?
Yes.
Instead of getting beyond that and actually going, what is it? And that's the meditative state that we're trying to get people to. And that's the whole point of koans, is to provoke learning in the way of awakening human consciousness. Hey, thanks for hanging with Hallie and I today and for listening to the show. However, if you are interested in getting a short email from me in your inbox each Tuesday when a new episode drops, you can. These emails are super short. I just cover whatever I happen to be thinking about each week, whether that's an article or a quote I've shared, a book I've read, or a new product that I'm loving, plus info on the latest episode of Business Meets Spirituality. If that sounds like something you want to check out, we'd love you to. Just go to adamhergenrother.com/email.